Right. Thank you, choir. How many of y'all looking forward to seeing the New Jerusalem? Somebody asked me just this past week, had I ever made it to the Holy Land? I said, no, I'm waiting on the New Jerusalem. I don't think there'll be terrorist activity in the New Jerusalem. Anyhow, if you have your Bibles, open to Ephesians, and we'll continue our study of this wonderful New Testament book. We've been in chapter 2 for a while. Maybe we'll get done today. Last time we looked at what a difference Jesus makes in our life. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, if you remember, it says that we are born in trouble. We're dead in trespasses and sins. Verse 12 says, at that time we're without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in this world. And then we said, we praise the Lord for verse 4, but God in His grace made a way for us to be saved through faith in Jesus Christ. And so now things are different. Look at now, verse 19. Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints, members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple unto the Lord, in whom you also, you church members, you Christians, are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. To illustrate this new life that we have in Christ, the apostle here refers to a common theme in the Bible concerning how a person can build a life that will stand for eternity. It involves building your life on the cornerstone. We see that in verse 20. I thought before we left this chapter that the cornerstone is a wonderful topic in Scripture, so I wanted to do a quick word study on that this morning. Chief cornerstone, first mentioned in the Old Testament in Psalm 118:21. The psalmist says, I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. A little bit later on, Isaiah the prophet in chapter 28 would say, therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion a stone for a foundation, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation, and whoever believes in Him shall not be ashamed. Also, I will make justice the measuring line and righteousness the plumb line. In the Gospels, Jesus reminds us that the very God who created this universe is offering us a plan for building your life that will stand the tests of time and eternity. He says, build your life on me, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and I will give you eternal life. This idea of the cornerstone is a word from God on how to build your life. God uses the illustration of a building several times in the Old Testament, as we just read. He also, these verses are referred to by Jesus in His preaching and by Peter and by Paul in the New Testament. The reason God uses building terms to illustrate how to build a life, I think the reason He uses that is because it's a timeless truth. It's one of those rules for the ages. Whether we're living in Old Testament times B.C. or 21st century A.D., we are familiar with buildings. You don't have to be a builder, but we've all seen some buildings under construction. You may have built your own house. Even if you're not a builder by trade, you understand the basics. You know, in Isaiah's time and in Paul's time, buildings were pretty much all made of stone. Modern times, we cheat. We use artificial stone known as concrete. But nevertheless, the principles pretty much work the same way. The fundamentals of building are pretty much the same. First of all, you have to build your life with a strong foundation that starts with corners. You dig down past the topsoil, past the sand, past the gravel to bedrock, and you lay a foundation stone, huge stones, rocks, to support the weight of the entire building. So it's very important to get the cornerstone done right. And the first foundation should be the cornerstone. That's where you start, because that's where the walls will meet. So you have to have a very firm place to put that corner. It must be strong, and it's a reference point for the rest of the building. As my daddy used to tell me, if the corner's not right, the rest of it's not going to be right. So the most important thing you can do is start your corners. Second thing is you build your life according to the rules, according to building codes. Isaiah refers to a measuring line and a plumb line attached at the corners. It's used to keep each course or layer of stone as you build your house, as you build your wall, keeps everything straight and square and level. And then you have to finish strong. Isaiah refers to a precious cornerstone. In the New Testament, Peter's using the same verse in 2 Peter chapter 2. He calls it a precious cornerstone, but it actually translates from the Greek as the capstone. He says, "Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but those who do not believe, the stone which the builders rejected has become the capstone or the headstone." So not only do you have to build with a huge stone at the base of your structure, but at the top. Once you finish your walls, you have to have a large stone to hold everything in place. And so that was known as the capstone. So the question is why is all this important? Well, on a sunny, beautiful day, it doesn't really matter how you build your life, or it doesn't matter whether you followed the rules. But the question is when the storms come, when the rains, when the floods, when the hail, when the high winds come. If the cornerstone, if your foundation is not strong, your building will wash away. A wall is not straight and square, and if a capstone is not in place, then the winds will blow down the sides, the walls of your house. So again, on a beautiful day, sometimes it doesn't seem to matter whether you're building your life right or not. But sooner or later, the storms come. How many of you have experienced a storm in your life? How many of you are going to face another one? Yeah, so that's why it's important. It's not so important for the pretty days, it's for the tough days. And that's where the analogy to our life comes in, whether or not we're ever going to build a building. Hopefully all of y'all are planning on trying to build a life in here this morning. And the question of the morning is will your life, will the life that you're building, will it stand the test of time and eternity? And of course, the psalmist and the prophet Isaiah say it will, if you build your life upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Isaiah says, "Thus says the Lord, behold," or "look," or "listen, the Lord lays in Zion a foundation, a place for you to begin your life." And then he says, "The Lord gives you a plumb line, a guide to measure your life as you build your life." And then finally, the Lord offers you a capstone to finish off your life with that will stand for all eternity. So the God of all creation, the architect of the universe, the master builder of matter, space, and time, is offering his services to you. And what the Lord tells us when he's talking about the cornerstone is, first of all, begin your life with a cornerstone of faith in God. Proverbs 3:5, one of the verses that I was taught to memorize as a boy, but I'm reaching a point where my memory don't work so well anymore, but it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not to your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him," what? "And he shall direct your paths." And that means trust God, and trust God early. Let him be the cornerstone at the beginning of your life. We're all tempted to be wise in our own eyes, to do things our own way, to choose other foundations for life. I remember when I went to college just up the road here, it was North Georgia College then instead of it being fancy university like it is now. But I remember witnessing to a friend. We were both seniors, fixing to leave college, and we were just out doing some military maneuvers one weekend, and I talked to him about becoming a Christian. And he told me, he said, "Well, I plan to do that someday, but there's so many other things that I want to experience first. There's so many things that I want to do first." And you know what? The world does offer a lot of other things. The world offers a lot of other things to do. There's academics and athletics and business and technology and travel and pleasure, and all these things are out there. And these pursuits are okay. They all have their place. They make a nice window for your building. They make a nice picture to hang on the wall of your building, but they are not suitable for a foundation because they will not stand the tests of time. For example, academic studies, they're all fine. Education is good. It beats ignorance anytime. How many of you know that? It's important to have a little smarts going on, but it has its limits. I mean, your academics are only as good as your first stroke or the onset of Alzheimer's or dementia, and then you forget everything that you've ever learned. So again, academics are a wonderful thing, but it's not a great foundation to build your life on. Athletics are fine until your first injury. How many of you watch these kids play over at the University of Georgia and they have that decision to make? Right now, I'm still relatively healthy. Should I go to the NFL? Am I that good? Or should I stay and play one more year at the university and risk breaking the leg and be done? And again, if you get by without injury, you have another storm comes along called aging. Is anybody in here familiar? I'm not as fast as I used to be. I'm not as agile as I used to be. Laura, don't let me on top of the house anymore. I don't know why. But athletics are wonderful. They're a nice window dressing, but they do not make a foundation for your life. Business is fine until that housing bubble bursts and the stock market dives 1,000 points like it did in 2008. Your 401k looks like a 201k when you get through with it. Your business fails. Maybe your business starts laying off and you lose your job. Again, business is fine when business is fine. But when the storm comes, it's not a great foundation either. Technology is fine. But I make a lot of trips to the hospital, and I've stood together with a lot of folks when the doctor comes in and says, we've tried everything that we know. We've done all that we can do. And we can't really do anything else. And then the EKG flatlines, and that's the end of technology. Technology is a wonderful thing, but it's not a foundation for your life. Travel is fine until you reach the point where the only traveling you're doing is from one doctor's office to another. Can I get a witness in this crowd? You know, again, travel is wonderful, but again, you reach the point where you no longer travel, and sometimes you can't remember where you traveled when you get back. Pleasure is also fine, but again, pleasure is temporary. It doesn't last very long. As Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes 12:1, listen up, youth. Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days come and the years draw near, when you say, I have no pleasure in them. Pleasure is fleeting. It quickly goes away. The things of the world, they add interest to your life, but you cannot let them be your foundation, because it's when, not if, the storms come. The storms will come. And ultimately, the Bible says there's a big storm coming called Judgment Day. Paul writes about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. No other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, and that is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation, great. But the day of judgment will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. The fire will test every man's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on endures, then he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss. And again, that's it. The only one that's going to make you through judgment day is your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only one to get you past that. All the other things that we spend our life worrying about really are not going to matter on that day. Those are the kinds of works that will be burned up. Matter of fact, I read a statement one time from a missionary named C.T. Studd. He was a missionary in China, India, and Africa along about 1900. And he wrote in his diary, only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only those things done for Christ will last. And that's why we need to start off, build your foundation, your cornerstone of your life with the Lord Jesus Christ. The second thing I want you to see about the cornerstone is build upon that cornerstone. Once you receive Christ as your Savior, build up your life based on that, on the Word of God. That is your plumb line. The Word of God is a plumb line that keeps your life straight and square and level. The early church referred to the Scriptures in Acts chapter 2 as the teaching of the apostles. Why? Because what were the apostles teaching? They were teaching the Old Testament, things they had learned from their Jewish culture, and they were also teaching what the Lord Jesus Christ had showed them in His life, and also how He'd taken those teachings from the Old Testament and fulfilled those in His own life. So that was the teaching of the apostles. If you'll look back to what I read a few moments ago, chapter 2, verse 20, it speaks of the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. If you want to live a life on the straight and narrow, get into the Word of God. Look at the teaching of the prophets from the Old Testament, the teaching of the apostles from the New Testament. And today, you know, we're surrounded by a politically correct relativism that teaches that it really doesn't matter how you build your life, that there really are no rules, there are no absolutes, there is no right, there is no wrong, everything's relative, everything depends on the situation. What I might think is right for me might not be right for you, and that's kind of the way things are rolling. There's no plumb line. You can stack the stones of your life any way you want to. You can build your life any way you want to. Everything works. But God's Word teaches that there is a standard, and the standard is His law, the commandments, the Ten Commandments. And all across the nation, you see people trying to cut this plumb line. They get rid of the Ten Commandments. Get them out of the school. The last 20, 30 years, that seems to be one of the standard lawsuits that's been going through all municipalities, is get rid of the commandments out of the schools, the courthouse, remove them from monuments. in city parks, get them out of the cemetery. Even veteran cemeteries are trying to sue to get landmarks out that have anything to do with the Lord or with His commandments. Even many churches and denominations are removing the Ten Commandments from their confessions of faith. We no longer want God's plumb line of what is good and right and straight. We no longer want to measure ourselves by God's yardstick. We're like the ancient Greek philosopher Protagoras, who said, man is the measure of all things. And we seem to be falling for that as a nation, that there is no God up there, that we just measure ourselves by whatever measure we want to. But the Bible still is here, and it's still the Word of God. And God's yardstick says there's only one God. He says, turn away from these gods and idols of this world out of your life. But the world says, well, that's not very tolerant. We ought to be tolerating all religions. They're all okay as long as you're sincere. They're all leading to the same place. Is that true? No. But nevertheless, things are changing here. God's plumb line says, take every seventh day off to rest your body and strengthen your soul in worship. But the world says, well, that doesn't make sense. How can I get more by working less? We need to be out there working more and more. Time is money, and I'm wasting both while I'm at church. I need to be somewhere else doing something. God's Word still says, take that time off. We need that in order to build our life upon Him. God's commandment says, honor and obey your parents. It will lengthen and strengthen your life. But the world says things are different now. Moms and dads are out of touch. They don't know what's going on. They don't understand. Children say, I'll agree with mom and dad as long as they agree with me, but not if we don't. God's yardstick says you shall not murder, but our world is developing and living in a culture of death. Get rid of the young if they're inconvenient. Get rid of the old when they're no longer productive. And it's not a big jump from there to get rid of anybody who stands in my way of me doing my life however I want it. And that's why when you flip on Atlanta television on the morning, they have what I call the murder report. How many people were killed last night because somebody got in my way of me living life the way that I want to? God's plumb line says, thou shalt not commit adultery, that we need strong families to build strong lives. But the world's decided that my selfish needs for self-fulfillment is more important than family. If it feels good, that's more important than if it is good. America has normalized premarital, extramarital, homosexual relationships. Pornography is a multi-billion dollar a year business. Sexual perversion is protected as freedom of expression. And we've started calling normal what God calls abominable. And somehow or another, we think America is going to go merrily along and that we're going to be strong again simply because we can create a few jobs. I got news for you. There's still a God in heaven, and He's got a different plumb line. And we need to get on with that. God's commandment says, you shall not lie, cheat, or steal from your neighbor. But our world's decided that that too depends on the situation. Dishonesty may be okay if it's for a good cause. For the last 8 years, the good cause was redistribution of wealth from whoever they call rich to whoever they call poor. In the Bible, that's simply called stealing. So instead of our lives being straight and square and level, we're building lives that are crooked, bulging, and leaning forward toward a fall. You need to get a hold of God's Word and figure out how to keep your life straight, how to build your life that will stand for eternity. So, the first, you begin with a cornerstone of faith in God, and then you build upon that cornerstone according to the Word of God. And then third and finally, we want to finish your life with a capstone of hope in God. Not only should we make Jesus Christ our cornerstone at the beginning of life, we need to make Jesus our capstone at the end of our life. And the question is, what makes a capstone, the head of the corner, the chief cornerstone that we read about here in this passage, what makes that so important, so precious? Well, what makes it so precious is the story that goes behind that, the story that goes behind the psalm that I read to you in the beginning. The head cornerstone story dates all the way back to the building of Solomon's temple. Solomon's temple was the most glorious temple there ever was. And of course, it got torn down during the Babylonian invasion. They tried to rebuild it during Herod's reign, but it was nothing like as grand as it was under Solomon. But Solomon's temple was a huge project. There were stone walls for the courtyard. There were stone walls for the apartments and offices of the police, of the priest. There were stone walls for the sanctuary itself, and then the holy place and the holy of holies. All those were stone walls. And it took 3,300 managers and 180,000 workers working 1 month on and 2 months off, and it took 7 years to complete the building of Solomon's temple. Another interesting thing about the temple is it was constructed in strict silence. You couldn't hear anything going on while they were putting it together. 1 Kings chapter 6 and verse 7 says, "The temple, when it was built with stone finished at the quarry, so that no hammer or chisel or any iron tool was heard in the temple when it was being built." All you heard was stones being slid into place. Each stone was perfectly cut to the exacting details on the blueprint, and it was done out in the quarries. So whenever the stone was transported into town and arrived at the Temple Mount, it would fit perfectly into place without any hammering and without any chiseling. And I got to tell you, those guys were better at building than I am, because there's a lot of sawing and chiseling and everything else when I do some. But anyhow, they had some great craftsmen working on this thing. Well, according to Jewish tradition, one huge stone was quarried and shaped and sent up to the Temple Mount. And when it got up on the Temple Mount, the builders couldn't find where it was supposed to be on the plans, so they pushed it aside. And there's limited space up on the Temple Mount with all these stones being put into place. And so this stone just kept getting in the way, and it kept being pushed a little bit further away. And then finally one day it actually got pushed off the side of the Temple Mount and went rolling all the way to the bottom of the Kidron Valley. And that's where it stayed. Then one day the building was almost finished. All they needed was the final cornerstone, the capstone up on top to hold the corner of the building, to the front corner of the building together, but they couldn't find it. So they sent to the quarries and said, "We're ready for the cornerstone." And the word came back from the quarry, "We delivered that stone years ago." Then one of the workers remembered that back in the early days, the stone got in the way and they pushed it down the side of the mountain. So with great effort, they went down and got a hold of this stone, drug it all the way back to the top of the hill. And guess what? When it got there, it fit into place without any hammering or chiseling. It went there just like it was made for it. And this is a story that became one of the praise songs in Israel from Psalm 118. Jesus sung it in Mark chapter 12 and verse 10. "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." You know, there was a literal fulfillment at the Temple Mount with this actual stone that the builders rejected actually being the finishing stone that was necessary to complete the temple. And of course, there were other stories where that happened throughout the Old Testament. One of them is King David. If you remember, he was the youngest son, the little boy that wasn't able to go off to war because they didn't think he was warrior material, left him home to look after daddy's sheep. And then all of a sudden, the son who was rejected, what? End up being the guy who slew Goliath and who became the greatest general in Israel's history and ultimately became the greatest king that there ever was in Israel's history. And of course, the nation Israel itself is a little nation. Compared it to all the other nations in the world, all the empires that ever was in the world, and it was always small, seemed like it was in the way. And for whatever reason, it seems like throughout their histories, they've always been rejected. Different kingdoms try to exterminate them and forget them, yet here they are at the end of the world. Israel is still a nation. Israel's still stuck in the Middle East out there, and it's almost like we're waiting to see what God's going to do with that nation too, with that rejected cornerstone. Of course, the ultimate fulfillment of this is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. God's great building plan in history is centered around Jesus being the precious chief cornerstone. But when he came, the world was not ready for him either. Isaiah chapter 53:2 described what it was going to be like when Jesus came. So he had no form or comeliness. In other words, Jesus wasn't particularly handsome. "When we saw him, there was no beauty in him that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him." The Apostle John says in John chapter 1, verse 11, Jesus came to his own, but his own did not receive him. He was rejected and dragged outside the city, ironically kicked down the mountain to a little hill in a rock quarry called Golgotha. Peter picks it up from there. If you remember, Peter, after Jesus died and rose again and ascended into heaven, Peter and John were preaching one day, and there was a lame guy, a guy who had never been able to stand. And remember, they told him, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And for that good deed, they were arrested. And they had to go before the chief priest, and they asked him, saying, "One more time, whose name is it that you guys have been preaching about out there?" And then it says, "Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for this good deed done to a helpless man and by what means he has been made well, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands before you whole. This stone, which the builders rejected, has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved than at the name of Jesus Christ. And somebody ought to say, amen. Amen. So Peter and John had seen the risen Savior. They had witnessed him finishing the work of God. He is, in fact, the finished work of God. He was the blessed hope that he would give to them that would sustain them through all the storms they faced in life. And that included the ultimate storm of death. Right after the crucifixion, these guys here were scared to death, hiding in a room, if you'll remember, the door locked and the table up against it and all this. Now these guys were boldly going and preaching the gospel. Why? Because they didn't have to fear death anymore because of what Jesus Christ had done for them. So nothing could rob them of their joy. No one could stop them from singing, "The stone which the builders rejected has become chief of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Of course, John takes that cornerstone thought to a higher level when he writes in the book of Revelation that the Lord says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the beginning and the end, who is and was and is to come, the Almighty. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. He is the cornerstone and capstone of our life." Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came to show us how to build our life, but we didn't want it that way, so we as a human race rejected him. But the stone which we rejected is now putting himself out there as a cornerstone of our faith, if you'll simply believe in him. And as you see in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 22 that I read a few moments ago, now we have the Holy Spirit. His Holy Spirit is living within us, and that is the earnest of our expectation of being able to live forever in a place called heaven. So Jesus came to be your Alpha, your Omega, your beginning and your end, your first, your last, and everything in between. And when it comes to building a life that will stand the test of time, there's really only one choice, and his name is Jesus. Jesus is our cornerstone, the foundation of our life in the beginning. Jesus is our plumb line, the one who gives us guidance to keep us on the straight, a square, level, narrow road to heaven. And he is the capstone to be with us when this life is over and take us through to the other side. So the question is won't you trust him while it's still called today? So many of life's tragedies could be avoided if we would only trust him and build our life around him. You know, several years ago, I was asked to do a funeral for an elderly lady in the church I was pastoring at the time. I only got to know her for a brief time before Alzheimer's struck. After that, she couldn't communicate anymore. As I understand her story, when she was a young woman, she was beautiful. I knew her husband, and he told me that when they started dating, he felt so proud of that because she was the prettiest girl in the county. She may not have been the prettiest girl in the county, but in his eyes, she was the prettiest girl in the county. She was a pretty girl. And she married this handsome young farmer, and it wasn't long before they had two beautiful daughters. But she was not content to be a beautiful flower on the edge of a hot South Georgia cotton field. So she decided to go to Washington, D.C. and make a life for herself. That's where the action was, and so her story kind of reminded me of the Kenny Rogers song. Y'all remember that? "You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille." Well, four hungry children and a crop in the field. Well, in this case, you had two little children and a crop in the field when she hugged them goodbye at the train station and left. She did go to Washington, D.C. She got a government job. It paid well. She had a good education. She enjoyed the social life up there, and she hobnobbed with the rich and powerful. But as I mentioned earlier in my sermon, beauty, like athleticism, doesn't last forever. Age has this way of subtly sneaking up on all of us. Strangely, after her retirement, she decided she wanted to move back to South Georgia and reunite with her family. Stranger still, they accepted her and brought her back, and they loved her and cared for her. it came time for me to do her funeral, and one of the daughters wanted me to include the old rugged cross in her eulogy. And I said, well, it's a beautiful song, but was it her favorite? I mean, why did she want that used in her eulogy? And she said, well, it was our mother's last intelligible words. Said, me and my sister were sitting with her at the nursing home the last time she ever said anything, and we were singing the old rugged cross just before she slipped into the oblivion known as Alzheimer's. I couldn't help but think about the irony. Here you have a beautiful, intelligent, well-educated, well-traveled, successful woman. She accomplished a lot. She was on the top of her field. She won lots of commendations, awards, plaques, and trophies. Still, her last recognizable words were, so I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. God in His mercy allowed this lady to reject Him in her youth, but in the end gave her time to make Him the cornerstone and capstone of her life. Now, I wish I could promise everybody in this building that you will have time to do that, but you know as well as I do that we don't know when our time will end. As James tells us, we don't know what tomorrow will bring. We have no promise of tomorrow. So rather than gambling the fact that maybe when I'm old and the last few breaths before I lose my mind and everything else, maybe, just maybe, I'll trust in Jesus Christ, there's a safer way to do that. And that is believe in Jesus Christ now. Make Him the cornerstone of your life. Make Him the counselor of your life as you go through your life. And then finally, hold on to Him as a capstone of your life when it comes time for this life to be over and for eternity to begin. Won't you do that? Won't you make Him your chief cornerstone of your life as we go to the Lord in prayer? Father, we thank You for Your word. We thank You, Lord, also for the illustrations. You could have left us just a list of commandments and says, that's it. But You not only gave us commandments, but You gave us stories of people throughout the Old Testament, those who trusted You and those who didn't trust You and the outcomes of their life. Lord, the whole reason and purpose for this sermon is to encourage people to be one of those positive stories where they make You the one who helps them build their life that will last for all eternity, that makes Jesus Christ the cornerstone, the counselor, the capstone throughout their whole life. We pray today that You would move among us by the power of Your Holy Spirit. Draw people to Yourself, Lord. Help us to get our lives straight before You so we'll not be ashamed at Your soon coming. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.